Thank you for tuning in to the Flying Dutchman podcast. We have a very special guest, Sofia Rivera, who is studying aerospace, where her future is going to take her into powered flight, rockets, jets, no telling. She flies drones, she drives fast cars, she rides a longboard, and apparently her favorite artist is Eazy-E. So without further ado, let's enjoy some pictures. And let's stop asking questions with Eazy-E. Let's go.
My style is a juvenile, ran with a gang, slammed in the meanwhile, banking. I specialize in ganking, white, Mexican brothers and others daily. It's all about coming up, making sure no punks are running up.
Trick up my sleeve, step with pep to the back of the house, looked in, all the lights are out, grab the door and it's locked, so easily made my way to the window.
Good morning, good day, good evening, wherever you are. I'd like to welcome you to the Flying Dutchman podcast. I'm your host, Dutch, and I'm excited today. We have, as aviation, most things military, but we also cover anything that breaks terra firma, we're going to be interested in. And this is the exciting part, is that we're going to be talking to a young lady that in San Jose State that is on a trajectory to be into the development of propulsion, whether that be with jet aircraft, ramjet, scramjet, whatever it might lead to. And spacecraft is also a potential in the end result of her studies and what she's doing now. And I'm fascinated by it. And it's not an area that I usually delve into in my own personal readings and stuff. And we're going to have some nice video clips of some of the things that she talks about. And I want to introduce you to her. This is Sofia Rivera. Am I getting that right?
Yeah.
All right. Well, welcome to the show, Sofia. And I want to thank you for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And you're attending San Jose State.
Yeah, I'm third year at San Jose State now.
Your third year now?
Third year, yeah.
Wow. And what are you doing there?
I'm pursuing my bachelor's in aerospace engineering.
Uh-huh.
I'm doing a five-year path. I'm on my third year currently. Doing 5 years just because I got a job and I could use more time to finish my classes without being too stressed out.
That's very good. That's a good business plan for yourself, not to be stressed out. That's what is your major exactly? What is the class to do what you want to do?
So aerospace engineering is basically anything aerospace. That includes aircraft, spacecraft, anything that flies. And that also includes like military and defense. So missiles, satellites, all that stuff. Personally, I've always been interested in the aircraft aspect. Mm-hmm. Of course, the spacecraft aspect, but I know more about aircraft than I do spacecraft.
Very cool. I want to know a little bit about you as a young girl. When did you get a spark for this, for aircraft, aviation, rocket motors, propulsion, whatever? When did that happen?
Oh, man. I'd like to say around like 7 years old was when I first started.
Really?
I'd say like a passion for aircraft. I always thought airplanes were really cool. I think one time in particular, we were going to Mexico and I was just especially excited to be on the plane and just experience the aircraft and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And this is a little ironic, but I think I got into aircraft because of this one show called Aircraft Disasters.
I know the show.
It's the documentary with the airplane crashes and stuff like that. So I really like that show just because it went behind like or it went and talked about the mechanics behind the aircraft and all that stuff, like what failed, how it's supposed to work, what didn't work, and like what they did to remedy the problem. And I kind of just went from there. And then I would watch like I liked watching plane spotting videos from people in airports. I especially had a big passion for like big aircraft. Like I really liked the 777, the A380, the AN225. I thought those were really
Oh,
cool.
yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. And when you initially liked these things and identified as you're growing up, at what point did you realize that I'm going to have to really focus on my school so that I can follow my passion or my interests? Because you can't get very far in that with a GED.
Yeah.
When did you start, because we all have fun in junior high and high school and elementary and all that, but at some point it's time to get serious with your future and prepare for that future. And I'm sure you have a good home base and stuff, but when did you really think that I got to get serious here if I want to achieve my dream of being involved in this?
Honestly, high school, especially maybe like halfway. Unfortunately, I didn't take my freshman and sophomore year too seriously. But then, junior and senior year, I was like, "Hey, I'm about to go to college. I should probably start like taking AP classes and stuff like that." Unfortunately, my high school didn't offer too many like engineering related classes to get you ready for college. I know some high schools do, but yeah, I started taking my education more seriously in high school. But I was also kind of blindsided when I got to college.
How
So,
so? How were you blindsided?
it was a huge reality check. I was going in here like really naive, thinking like, oh, it's not going to be too difficult. It's just going to be some like math or whatever. All right, no, but it's like everything that I didn't think would be, like I didn't think the engineering experience was going to be as heavy as it is.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think like my first semester I did okay, and then my second semester I failed a few classes because I didn't take my study seriously. But it blindsided me because I was taking a bunch of classes that other people had taken in high school already, but I hadn't taken those classes in high school because my counselors didn't think it would be that important for me. So I was kind of starting from like, I don't want to say like a lower level than everybody else, but I was learning a lot of things that a lot of other people already knew,
Have you ever felt like going back to high school and put a little reality on them counselors? Get misguiding.
Sometimes I wish they were a little tougher and saying like, "Hey, if you want to go into engineering, you got to take these classes," but they never said that to me. They were always like the bare minimum, like, "Oh, you
Got it.
graduated high school, good luck," right?
Okay, yeah, there you go. You're off their desk. Well,
Yeah.
it sounds like that you've pulled the bootstraps up, as they say, and you're in your third year of 5 years, so that the classes are only going to get harder, or they are.
Yeah, they're gonna get a lot harder. I'd say I'm taking the easier classes of my major. Like I'm already like taking my major specific classes, but the ones that I'm taking right now are pretty like intro level, so I'm gonna get into like the harder stuff next year, and I'm really nervous, but also excited because I see school as an investment. You're investing a lot of money and time to set yourself up for life. So I'm not worried. I think I'll be okay.
I think you will be okay. And can you tell me what some of those classes are that you're taking
Like classes I'm taking currently or.
currently?
Currently, I'm taking flight mechanics, intro to circuits, material science, and what else am I taking? Linear algebra.
Oh, wow. And you're going to be taking in the future, what would those classes be?
The future, so like next semester, I think I'm gonna start taking my propulsion classes next semester. Another aerodynamics class, structures. dynamics, vector dynamics. I'm not too sure. Physics, I have another physics class to get through. But yeah, I have so many classes that I already lost track.
Wow, that's a pretty big handful, huh? That's definitely
Yeah.
a handful. And you mentioned that you are taking a little bit light on classes, but you have a job as well. I mean, you're not just full-time student, you also have a job.
Yeah.
What do you
Yeah.
do?
I'm a well, technically my title now is a just a what's it called? Well, I'm a manufacturing technician. I'm also a flight test engineer. So I work with drones, security drones, and I'm a test pilot for those drones. I make sure I put them through a validation process, and I make sure that they're good to go for our customers. And I also am a part of the manufacturing team, so I help build the drones and I build the bases that the drones belong in. Yeah, so I'm pretty much like I just do whatever they need me to do. But yeah, I've been here for 2 years, going on my third now.
That's pretty impressive. And these are surveillance drones. So when
Yeah.
you're test flying them, are you using them in like a real world scenario?
We put them through a bunch of tests to basically test the hardware and the software to make sure that they'll perform as they should on customer sites. So they're autonomous drones. So the way that they work, we call them a drone in a box. It's basically like a base station. The base station opens up, the drone flies, and it does whatever pre-programmed mission you want it to do. We market them as autonomous drones. And you can basically program them to say you want to like secure a perimeter or watch a perimeter. You can make the drone fly in that path, schedule it for a certain time that you want it to fly. And our drones have RGB cameras, so it's basically like the camera on your phone where you see like color and everything. And then we have thermal cameras, which does as the name implies. You can see thermal profiles of people, animals, cars,
Rodents.
rodents. Yeah, so basically anything shows up on the camera. And then we have cameras that track beacons. So if, per se, like our bases, when they open up, they have a beacon in the middle. So when the drone is coming back, it tracks the beacon and it starts landing in place and it follows the beacon all the way down. So it lands by itself, it takes off by itself. It comes back if the battery's too low. It has a lot of cool features.
Are these infrared beacons? Are they
Yeah.
okay? And the camera is on there is also thermal capability. Can you switch from white hot to black hot thermal on
Yeah.
those?
Yeah. We have a bunch of different settings on the thermal camera. We have like, I think one of them's called Predator Vision. I think that one's really cool.
Is it just what you think it would look like?
It's like I don't really know how to describe it.
Yeah, I
I'm
get
not
what
too
you're doing.
familiar with like why the thermal profiles are named the way they
Okay.
are. Yeah.
That's cool. And if there's surveillance drones, like some helicopters, especially the stealth version of the Black Hawk helicopter is an example, the rotors are not your typical rotors as a typical UH-60 platform. It makes them quieter. Do these drones have a different style of prop than a normal
So,
DSC drone or
our drones, we currently have carbon fiber props on them. They're about like this long. The profile that we use on those drones aren't really designed for being the quietest. They're more for like efficiency, so your battery lasts longer. We are actually designing another we have a prototype of another drone. Like a newer model called the Block 3. We categorize our drones in like blocks. We have like the Block 1, 1.5. Currently we're on 1.5, or not Block 3, Block 2. So we're currently developing Block 2, which is supposed to be a stealthier version of the drone that we have right now. It actually is going to have like props like this big. I actually have one here if you'd like to see.
I would love to see this prop.
Oh Jesus. Yeah. These drones, our current drones, the Block 1.5s, they currently have a battery life of about like 30 to 40 minutes. The Block 2s are supposed to have like battery life of 40 to 50 minutes, I think. And they're really quiet. They sound like these huge bugs, like these big wasps. That's the best way I can describe it. And they're really scary sounding. But we fly them to a height where like you can barely hear them.
Yeah,
Yeah,
they
even our
probably
drone.
sound like a murder hornet. You're going to scare any Japanese that might be out and about. Gee, with
Yeah.
crickets.
So this is the prop or one of the like tester props that we have.
You guys manufacture that?
We don't. We don't. We order these from a third party, and our company is actually developing a prop. I don't know if it's patent pending, but we're developing a prop that will be one, quiet, and two, very efficient.
Lift capability. Can
But
you
this
hold
one,
that hold that horizontally for me for a second? I want to see the
like
prop.
this.
No, go ahead and go flat as if it was in flight. There you go. And then give it just a gentle turn. I want to see something.
So
That
you'll
takes
see
a
the pitches
big
move.
bite of air, doesn't it?
Yeah, the pitch is like, let's see if you can see it on camera, but yeah,
Yeah.
maybe.
There you go. It's like
Yeah,
you
so
rip
this
that
one
off of
off of
777.
the crash a crash drone. My coworker Rick, he's really cool. He's kind of the head of developing the Block 2. We call it the pancake. He actually gave
Pancake.
me after we had a crash,
Oh
because
no.
I had mentioned to him that I really like that style of propeller, and I have a whole collection of like broken propellers back home.
I think at back home where you grew up or you live, your parents' house, is that's back home, right?
Yeah.
You probably have a number of aviation type items in that back home, right?
Oh, yeah.
And I'm looking over your right shoulder, my left. There's a vase, a green vase with some,
Yeah.
can you bring that to the camera? I want to see what's on there.
Yeah, so I have a Sophia sticker.
That is
Not
too cool.
familiar with
Tell
it.
us about tell what does Sophia stand for?
So Sophia stands for Stratospheric Observatory for Infrared Astronomy. It's basically the 747 SP. So a lot of people are familiar with the 747, but the SP, some people joke that SP stands for short plane because that's what it is. So the 747 SP is a shorter version of the 747. It's a more compact version, and NASA uses this plane to mount a telescope. I think you can see it on the sticker,
I
but they
can.
mount a giant telescope in the back, and they go up really high, and they look at like the they look at the sky through infrared, the infrared telescope, and they go up and do missions for like multiple hours at a time. I think my old pre-calculus teacher, he was actually on one of these missions, and he said that his mission was about like 12 hours long. And while they were up there, they were gathering like a whole bunch of data, and they took a lot of cool pictures. Yeah, he's the one who gave me the sticker,
That's
so I
very
think it's really cool
thoughtful.
that I have that my name means something to
And your
NASA.
name. There you are. There you are. And I want you to for me and my interest is I saw other stickers, and you could gain a lot about a person's personality and stuff by the stickers. I've seen people with stickers all over their car, and you kind of get an idea where their head's at, or sometimes it's political, sometimes it's crypto. Or whatever, but I noticed a hornet on there. But could you show us some of your stickers? I'm gonna get an idea of who Sophia,
Yeah.
unless
So
there's
this
inappropriate or
one,
something that,
no. So this
In-N-Out
one,
Burger, yep.
I forgot where I got this one. I think I got it at a
Let's
space
see it
museum.
again.
Check
Okay,
that
so
out.
the okay, we got the astronauts' names
Yeah.
and Shuttle Transport 126. And do we know if that's the Columbia or Atlantis or who is that? Atlant
This one, I'm not too sure. I don't think
yeah,
it's.
doesn't say. I'm not that
No.
well versed. Then you got an F-18 Shadow.
Oh man, this one washed off. I put in the dishwasher and it fell off. But yeah,
Oh,
and I got an In-N-Out sticker right here.
there
I
you
think
go. There's a double. There's a Flying Dutchman hamburger at In-N-Out. Did you know that?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, if you order a Flying Dutchman at In-N-Out, it's a double cheese double patty hamburger.
Oh, it's like an actual
It's an
menu.
actual, yeah. So you know how In-N-Out has like secret menus,
Yeah.
double doubles, all, yeah. Well, the Flying Dutchman is actually one there.
If you said that, if you
They would know
marketed
which if you, yeah. I mean, when I go there, I flash stickers. I go, give me one of these, and it's my opportunity to
market, yeah.
market myself. Yeah. So I think In-N-Out's probably not the best market vehicle. Oh, what do you got there?
I have my other water bottle. I was just looking to see if I had more stickers to show you, and I do. I have a few right
Yeah.
here. I have my BMW Car Club of America sticker.
Let me
The
see. Yeah, I wanted to talk about this. You're just not all studies. You have, oh, that's cool. You have hobbies as well. Let's talk about this. We're going to circle back to your career path that you're on with school and stuff. We're going to talk a little bit about that. But I want to know about what do you do for fun? Because it's not all studies for you. Though you're a serious-minded woman, you've got a job flying drones, test flying drones, which is cool. And you've got your studies. You're going to be getting into harder studies as you go on, thermodynamics and pulse, all that stuff. But you got to relax somehow. And the BMW, you have a BMW.
Yeah, I do.
Do
I
you?
do. Yeah.
I'm gonna ask for a picture so I can add this to the show. And right now, as we're speaking, I'm probably will have that photo on there. But what color, what year, and what is it?
So I have a red 2006 325. It's a sports sedan. It's red. It's probably one of like the one of the cooler colors that BMW ever made, and I believe they only ever made that color, the specific red that I have on my car that year. So my car, I'd say, is
Wow.
like pretty rare, or not pretty rare, but like it's rarer than other cars. I named him Eric because I really like Eazy-E, and I don't know, I just thought I'd name him Eric because Eazy-E's real name is Eric.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, his name is Eric Wright, and I was like, let me name my car Eric too, because it's a cool name, whatever.
I think my daughter's named their cars too.
Yeah,
Yeah.
I've named all of my dad's cars. Yeah, I guess that's like my job now.
Yeah, you name people's cars. What do you do
Yeah.
with your car?
I drive it, obviously.
Yeah.
It's a daily, so I commute in it, I go back home. Every now and then, I like to go on cruises with my boyfriend and our friends. What else? I've been trying to autocross it for a few months now, but I keep having issues with it to the point where like I can't take it right now. But hopefully in the future.
What is
I'm sorry.
autocross? What is autocross?
So autocross is a it's basically like a course, like an obstacle course, and it tests a driver's like technical skills. So a lot of like sharp turns. Timing when to throttle and when to let off the throttle and stuff like that. So it's really cool. It's very technical, and it really tests and pushes like the limits of your driving. The goal of it is to see how fast you can make it through the course. It's all about car control. It's pretty difficult.
That's a very good skill too to have, and
Yeah.
to have it
Yeah.
in your pocket just commuting. You're in the Bay Area, and
Oh
people
yeah.
not familiar with the Bay Area, it can be best described as harrowing.
Yeah.
And a lot of cars, a lot of people, and yeah, defensive driving is on another level.
Oh, absolutely. It's a
Yeah.
really cool experience because if you go as a passenger, you get to ride in other people's cars, and there's a lot of cool cars there. I've been able to ride in a bunch of like GT4 RSs, GT3 RSs, which is actually one of my dream cars. A lot of M cars, BMWs. It's a BMW car club, but like any car can join. There's a bunch of nice cars. I've been in a Corvette, a bunch of Miatas. Just yeah.
I think one day I'm gonna bust out my 2003 Avalon.
I mean, anybody can join. Like you'd be surprised at some of the cars that actually autocross.
Really, is this where I've seen like a big open parking lot with a bunch of cones and a bunch of
Yeah.
people's? Okay, autocross. That's
We
pretty
actually,
interesting.
yeah, we've been to autocrosses at Crow's Landing. So the old
Oh, I know.
NASA airstrip. Yeah.
Yeah, anybody out there, look up Crow's Landing. That's in the Central Valley, the west side of it, opposite of San Jose, probably, huh? On the other side of the mountains.
Yeah.
That'd be about right. It during World War II, the Army Air Force used it as a training, and NASA took it over. And I don't know exactly what NASA was doing with it, but it's opened and you're able to do autocrosses there. Yeah, it's a. I'll have to look at. Seems like it's like two runways that kind of cross each other. I might be
Yeah.
wrong, but is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's kind of like in the middle of nowhere, and that's pretty cool. But to get there, you probably do you go through the mountain range, or do you come around the other way through Livermore Way?
We have to go through the Livermore Way just
Oh.
because of see, like I've never taken my car there. We always take my boyfriend's, but his car has like really stiff suspension, so like you feel everything. You can't really take it
Oh,
because
those are
the
some
car feels
aggressive
like it's
back
gonna fall
roads.
apart.
Yeah, he's gonna want to take your car. But the back roads, if I remember correctly, were pretty aggressive. And
Oh yeah.
you would think you're definitely not in California on those. You also in our pre-interview, you shared that you also ride a longboard of some sort.
Yeah.
What is that?
I have an electric longboard. It's a carbon fiber Evolve GTR, I believe. Yeah, so it's basically what it sounds like. It's an electric longboard. You don't really have to, you don't have to push with it. You just press a button on a remote and you can just like zoom around and stuff like that. I wear a bunch of safety gear because I go really fast on it. I actually have my helmet right here if you want to see it.
Yeah, I do. This is a safety.
Yeah. So this is the helmet that I wear. It's pretty
Wow.
unique
That's
looking. I got little fins on the top
Yeah,
for
those are aftermarket fins.
yeah. So
That's I would just like to wear that on my riding lawnmower. That's a
yeah.
pretty cool helmet. That's
Up like that, and then I got like a little intercom system here. So like if somebody calls me, I could just call them back, listen to music, all that stuff.
very cool. How fast can you get up on this longboard on a straightaway?
Like 30, almost 30 miles an hour.
Wow, that's fast. And what kind of range do you get if you weren't going, if you were doing 15 miles an hour, what kind of range? Is it measured in miles or hours or minutes?
Miles. Yeah, so
Wow.
I've gotten it up to about like 30. I've never really like tested the range limits of the longboard, but I've gotten it up to about like 30 on one charge.
Wow. So it gets you where you want to go.
Oh yeah.
On campus?
On campus, around the city, just like joyriding. I like to go on joyrides around the city. On campus too, because like the campus is pretty smooth, so it's nice.
Okay.
Yeah, that it's kind of funny because at the beginning of the year when everybody was moving in, I would ride around and like parents would look at me and they'd be like, "What in the world? Like, what kind of school is this?"
Yeah.
Right? People recognize me. I've been like spotted. I've been posted on like people's Instagrams and stuff like that because they're like, "What in the world? Like, what is that?" They just think it's like some spectacle. I think it's really funny.
That's cool. Maybe sometime I can get you introduced to show and all your gear. Just come to a stop, throw open the shield, and say, "You're watching the Flying Dutchman podcast." That'd look cool.
That'd be
Then
cool. Yeah.
shut the shield and take off.
That'd be cool.
That
I'd like to
do you
do
have a
that.
group of people that share the same
Yeah. Yeah.
longboard riding?
Yeah. We call ourselves the Float Addicts. I actually have a sticker here.
The
The Float
float
Addicts.
addicts. Is that what it's called? Floating?
Yeah. So it's a San Jose-based group. Floating is technically a term used for people on one wheels because they
Oh,
look
I've seen
different
those.
when they're riding around. It's based on one wheel riding, but like anybody can join. So anybody on like four wheels or a one wheel or like an electric unicycle or anything. Anybody's encouraged to join. Just any electric, like portable electric vehicles is what we call them.
Okay.
Yeah. So we usually host group rides every first Friday of the month, and sometimes people will just host their own rides, and we just go through San Jose and we go through a bunch of different places. It's really fun. It's really cool.
That would be fun, especially when you're sharing something you like with other people and friends and get to meet
Yeah.
people. Think that'll be something you'll do for a long time?
I hope so. I feel
Why
like my
not?
lung is kind of on its last legs, and getting a replacement one is going to be really expensive. But to be fair, I do beat it up pretty often, so like it's kind of bound to happen.
Yeah, I can see a little adventure girl in you there. And you know what? This is your opportunity now to appeal to your mom and dad while you're on the show to start saving to buy you a longboard because I don't know
That's pretty nice.
when's your birthday, Sophie?
August 9th, so it's coming up. Well, not.
Well, happy birthday. I look for that longboard. We'll
Yeah.
send a direct message to your folks on your behalf in the future.
Okay.
All right. So, okay. So now let's and I'm glad that you shared what your hobbies are and stuff like that, because we can't take ourselves too serious and we can't not give us some good quality time, a work study life balance, so as they say. Now, when you hit the corporate world, they'll say that, but they don't practice that for the most
No.
part. But that's what it's all about. So now we're looking at you're in your third year of a 5 year. You are probably now entering the cusp of where I forget the term for it, but if you were to do a summer stint somewhere, or what is the word I'm looking for? If an internship or something to
An
that
internship,
effect.
yeah.
Yeah. Are there opportunities for you? You've got your drone action going, but is there opportunities for you in the field, the career path that you're heading?
Oh, there's plenty of, well, I live in Silicon Valley, which is like the heart of all technology here in California, right? Some might argue the entire United States. But yeah, there's plenty of opportunity here. It's just a matter of looking and like being motivated enough to apply. I applied to a Lockheed internship not that long ago, but I haven't heard back, which like is unfortunate, but there's so many people that want to do that. I think I encountered them at a job fair, and they thought my resume was pretty cool because of my testing experience, and they were looking for testers. That is a growing field in itself, like flight testing, just testing in general, which is what I've been doing, specialty. So they were pretty impressed by that, and I was hoping to hear back. I wonder if I'll hear back. I don't know when they're supposed to get back to us, but that was a few months ago.
Okay, well, you're probably right on course for them, and they're getting back to you. And also, I know that Moffett Field isn't that far away, and NASA has a research laboratory there, right?
Yeah, I have a few friends that actually work there.
Oh, cool.
It's about like a 30-minute drive. It's actually like right across from where I work. Like you could see Moffitt from my office.
Oh, yeah.
So sometimes like when the president or the first lady or the vice president, if they're flying in, you could usually see them flying in from
They'll
my
use
job.
Moffitt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Plus, Moffitt, for people that might not know, has two large hangars that during the dirigible days in the Navy's pre-World War II, World War II, is that these were hangars, and they are huge. And it wasn't uncommon for these hangars to have their own weather inside. They would actually form clouds inside of them.
Yeah.
Huge. Yeah, that's pretty cool. So I do hope that you get the internship that you want. Where is Lockheed Martin? Is or Lockheed, where would that internship be?
They said that it would be in Louisiana, that they're going to
Oh.
be doing some like propulsion related testing there. So of course I was really excited about that. So it would be really cool to get some hands-on experience and see how the field is over there. And of course, like getting away from California for a week or two would be pretty cool too.
It would, and it might even make things a little more exciting as far as like getting out of California and seeing like somewhere like Louisiana. I don't know, just the different foods. That's what I'd be focused on. Where do you see yourself in 5 years from
Well, graduated. Graduated from college. Hopefully I have my own place. That'd be really nice. Working full time, finally being able to achieve or start the hobbies that I've been wanting to start, because I'll have more time. Hopefully working on some really cool projects. Maybe fix up my car. Being able to travel a little more. I've been wanting to travel to a few places. What else? My brother's going to graduate high school in those 5 years, so it'd be really cool to see him graduate and have him come to my graduation. It's really weird seeing my brother grow up, especially because I'm away in college, and every time I come back, he's like taller, or he just looks different, so see how my family's doing in 5 years. I don't know. There's just so much that I see in the future. It's just a lot of uncertainty, but I do know, I'm still going to be pursuing like my goals in the next 5 years.
So let me ask you this. Do you know the difference between a ramjet and a scramjet?
A ramjet, I believe, is like, obviously it's a really powerful jet engine, and then a scramjet is an even more powerful version of that engine. But I'm not too sure about like the specifics.
Now, if you were given two job opportunities, one is developing jet engines for air-breathing aircraft, and the other is helping develop engines, motors, I'm not sure you call them, for space flight. Where would you want to go with that?
Space flight for sure.
Space flight?
Well, I think that like air breathing engines here, like on Earth or whatever, are really cool. Like I've always been fascinated with them. I feel like the future is in space flight. And I just find it so much cooler. Like I used to be really into the space shuttles when they were around, and I wish they were still around because I think they're really cool and iconic. But I just think I don't know what it is. I think it's like how loud they are, how powerful they are. Something man-made can do something as cool as spacecraft, and getting like a really heavy spacecraft into space, I just think all of that stuff's really cool, and I want to work on something like that in the future.
Space flight part. I have no doubt, as we talk, learning your personality, what you do for fun. You're not crocheting, you're riding a longboard up to 30 miles an hour. You've got a killer BMW, a good year of a BMW, a good model, and the color red. I wasn't, I didn't know that. It's like a short run of that color. And I just think that you're going to do quite well. You have a good head on your shoulders.
Thanks.
Yeah. And you like airplanes, so you're not half bad. But is there, if you went back in time and met 10-year-old Sophia, what would you say to her?
10-year-old me, that the space industry was going to be like so much bigger than you could have imagined. That pursuing something like this is worth it. Take school more seriously. Don't just focus on like the fun aspect of it. Like take it more seriously because it'll pay off. Like even though it's hard right now, it'll be so worth it after you're done. 10-year-old me doesn't even know like what chemistry is, right? But I'd tell her to take chemistry in high school so you don't fail it in college like I did. But yeah, like take high school seriously. Like, yeah, it's all fun and stuff, but also do what you got to do.
There you are. And
And don't,
I asked you that question, because I could have asked you, what advice would you have for young people out there? But I thought that I would get a better feedback from you if it was you that you were talking to, because everything that you just said to yourself as a 10-year-old, that is awesome advice for young people out there. And to kind of buckle up, get a little serious, get the fun out of the way, or carve fun time out, but achieve your dreams. It's just, there's so much, we're on the edge of a different technological advancements, and the sky's the limit. And if you want to have a career that provides a good income, and so you can enjoy things you like travel, have a your hobby, your BMW, and put all those things into it, they cost money. And you earn it. And there's something that's so satisfying that you did yourself. and you achieved your dreams and stuff, Sophia. And I want to come back. I hope in my retirement days with this podcast and YouTube channel and stuff, I hope that I'm around in 5 years, because I would so love to have you back on the show in several years from now, when you're out of school, you're with a company, and there might be things that you can't talk about. But before we close, you were involved with model rocketry also, weren't you? At some
Yeah.
point, when was that?
It all started in high school. Well, actually, like my interest in model rocketry started in elementary school, but I didn't pursue it until my senior year of high school when I started my own club, the Model Aerospace Club. We did basically what it sounds like. We made rockets, we launched them. We even participated in the American Rocketry Challenge.
Oh.
Which was basically design a rocket that would hold an egg and that would fly up at a certain altitude, stay in the air for a certain amount of time, and of course, like, the egg would have to be intact, you know. So it was a competition, and like, schools would win a bunch of money. We were able to get a grant of like $5,000, I think, to just build rockets, you know. And we would
Wow.
build sessions in our friends' like backyards and like people's houses, and we would test them. We would test our like prototypes and stuff at the park. I remember this one time we went to the park to test one of our parachutes because we made it out of like trash bags because we didn't have any money. We made a parachute out of trash bags and duct tape, and we tested it on top of like one of the play structures, and we kind of just like threw it off and see what it did. So I did that in high school, and then I joined the rocket club at my college. The San Jose State Rocket Club, and I was an officer for pretty much the whole time that I was there. I started off as an auxiliary officer, so I was kind of like an assistant to the officer team, and then eventually I became vice president and then president. So I did that for a while, and now I'm not that involved in rocketry. I actually have my rocket here if you want to see it.
I'd like to see it if you got it
Yeah,
handy.
here. Yeah, I have to go get it. So I got this big guy.
Oh, you're not getting any phone calls from Hamas, are you? That looks like something they'd like to get
No.
hold of.
So this is Garrett. This is my rocket.
Garrett?
Garrett, yeah.
That's funny. What kind of altitude can you get with that bad boy?
I think this one I got it up to like 10. No, like 7,000. I don't remember. 5,000, somewhere like that.
What
It was.
arrows? Where did you launch it from without taking out a Cessna or a 37?
We went to a launch site in Fresno, a place called Helm. It was like on a farmland, and we launched through Tripoli, and they have connections with like people in land and stuff like that. And we had a column of airspace dedicated to like a whole day of rocket launching and stuff like that. And we would take people, and they would launch the rockets there.
That is a cool rocket. And what, there it is, Garrett. That's interesting. And what little I know about rockets is there's like motors or A, B, C, D little solid propellant rockets for the testies that you see at hobby shops or whatever. So what the heck?
This is an
What?
H-class motor. This is the
Wow.
original motor that I used when I launched. I never took
Uh-huh.
it out.
So it's
Yeah, this is.
expanded at this time. That rocket's already been
Yeah.
expanded.
Yeah. So that's an H-class motor. I think these go up to like O-class, and the O-class motors are about like that. No, they're like that long. They're huge. They're massive.
Does it require a certificate or something to purchase that rocket motor?
So that's what we do at the Rocket Club. We basically work to get members their certification. We have three levels, level three being the highest, and then level one being starting out. I only ever made it to my level one just because I didn't have time to build another level two rocket. But I believe so everybody starts out with nothing, and then we take them to go launch their rocket. And through Tripoli, they get their certification. So once they get their certification, they can buy their own rocket motors and then build their own rockets and do all that kind of stuff. But their first launch would be through the club under like supervision and everything. I have my certification. I don't know if it's expired yet, but at some point I was level one certified to
Wow.
build and launch rockets. Yeah.
many pounds of thrust would that motor produce?
I think they measure it in newtons. I'm not too sure how many newtons this one has. I can look it up for you and
No,
tell
that's
you.
a
Yeah. But I'm not too sure.
yeah.
I could show you like the internals and stuff as well. But yeah, I named this rocket after my welding teacher who unfortunately passed away my first year of college. So I wanted to pay tribute to him because he basically taught me everything I know when it comes to like woodworking, welding, metalworking, all that kind of stuff. So I was like, this would be a good tribute to him.
That's
But
very nice.
yeah, here's the parachute, and then this is thermal padding that you would wrap the parachute in, so on ejection the parachute won't catch on fire. Yeah, and it's just this like long cord that comes out of the rocket, and yeah. Oh, geez,
That's
I'm
very
getting.
cool. You were now you got such a mess to clean up after this interview, huh?
Yeah.
Well, that's very cool, Sophia, that you have a lot of things that make up who you are, that my conclusion is that you're going to be very successful in your endeavors, whether it be rockets or jet engines or whatever. But I find that pretty impressive.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I'm hoping that people that watch this episode find some motivation from this, and perhaps they have children that have an interest in your path. Your advice to yourself as a 10-year-old girl is good advice. Rocket club, welding, woodworking. You have your passion, the need for speed with your longboard and your BMW, and some tough classes there. We got what? Thermodynamics.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's some other dynamics too, like fluid dynamics or.
Fluid dynamics, computational fluid dynamics. Think like what was the other one? I don't remember what it was called, but it had something to do with like space and how planets and like different celestial bodies work. So yeah, there's just so many classes that I have to take, but I'm excited. I'm excited because I know that it's stuff that I've wanted to learned since I was little.
Yeah, that's
Yeah.
awesome.
Oh, I did think of like another piece of advice that I'd tell myself. Like just try your best not to compare yourself to other people. You know, other people might look like they're doing well off and that they're like acing their tests and doing all that stuff, and you might feel like, oh, like why am I not getting those scores? But you have to remember that there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes. It's not just, oh, these people are really good at school. Or these people are really good at whatever they do, right? It's not just like black and white. And just because other people are doing better than you doesn't mean that you can't excel in the same thing or you can't excel in something else. So everybody's going through it, everybody's struggling. It's not just you, you know. And sometimes I have to remind myself because I'm like, oh, I failed this test. Like, why isn't everybody else doing as bad as me? What am I doing wrong? Right? When in reality, I just, you know, some people are better at certain things and others, you know.
Yeah, the first thing is to compare yourself with somebody else when you're on your own journey. You're not.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very good. Well, Sophia, I think we're just about there. Do you have any questions for me, or I not that I have anything to offer, but I do want to thank you for being on my show.
Yeah, thank you for
And
having me.
we're coming away. We've learned a lot, and there's a lot of wisdom that's going to be imparted from this episode on some individuals out there that we'll probably never know. So I want to thank you for that. We'll talk offline. And then we'll be in touch, okay? And especially for another show down the road after a few years.
That'd be
Cool.
awesome.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let me say goodbye to everybody. And thank you for joining us, myself and Sophia, on the Flying Dutchman podcast. And we look forward to you on our next podcast. Thank you.
My style is a juvenile, ran with a gang, slammed in the meanwhile, breaking. I specialize in ganking, white, Mexican brothers and others daily. It's all about coming up, making sure no punks are running up. It went in one ear and out the other, ran my gang, so under.
for some people to leave. I got another trick up my sleeve. Step with pep to the back of the house, looked in. All the lights are out. Grab the door and it's locked, so easily made my way to the window. Lift it up slow, cause it takes time in. Looked around and then I climbed in. Once inside, I start taking, cause you know.